I'd love to go ahead and introduce in the lineup. If you've got them in a line on your screen, we have Geralyn Ducady, who is the director of the Newell D. Goff Center for Education and Public Programs at the Rhode Island Historical Society in Providence, Rhode Island, and the assistant director of the Museum of Work and Culture, Sarah Carr. Additionally, we have Cherie Kelly, who is the National World War I Museum and Memorial School Programs Manager, who are joining us today in our conversation. Today, we're going to be talking quickly about the direct impact that World War I had on a centennial that's coming up here in August of 2020, the passage of the amendment, the ratification, pardon me, of the amendment, the 19th Amendment, which provided that you could not discriminate on gender within the United States for voting. Now, that's not actually to say the same as it provided all women the right to vote. And that is a level of detail that we're going to explore a little bit later on. The National World War I Museum and Memorial, if you have not joined us before in that space, we are located in Kansas City, Missouri, where we've been since 1926, when we opened, and we are doing this workshop as part of the centennial commemoration of World War I in partnership with the United States World War I Centennial Commission through funding by the United States Congress, who, as this effort to commemorate at this global devastation, this moment that completely changes the 20th and the 21st centuries. It was this opportunity to not only continue the conversation, but also highlight all of these incredible projects, and in particular, incredible teaching resources that were built between 2014 and 2019, what many consider to be the centennial of World War I. With that, and hopefully, again, you've got a good beverage in hand and are in a really comfortable space, I would like to, I would like to introduce Geralyn Ducady, the director of the Newell D. Goff Center for Education and Public Programs at the Rhode Island Historical Society, to talk a little bit more about the Rhode Island Historical Society and about some amazing things that you all are doing there.
Well, thank you, Laura. I want to highlight one of the projects we've been working on called EnCompass. It's our online digital textbook. So I am going to share my screen, which I think will kick your share screen off. So let's hope this works the way we want it to. All right, did that work? Can everyone see my, all right. So I'm starting from our webpage, which is just rihs.org. If you go to education, you can find the link to EnCompass right here. I'll talk about lesson plans as well that we have. And this brings you to the about page, but the main page is right here, and you can approach it a couple of ways. Right now, we have 5 chapters. We're working on 7 additional chapters through a grant from the Rhode Island Council for the Humanities that should all be up by the fall. You can look at the chapters here. You can go to the table of contents, and the way each chapter is set up, and I'll highlight our women's suffrage in a moment, but the way each chapter is set up is there is a main essay written by a local scholar, and we highlight primary and secondary sources, but mostly primary sources from our collections. We do sometimes feature primary resources from our organizations that are nearby that we work with. We have some of the chapters also have lesson plans and an additional resources page, and I'll go through this with the suffrage chapter so you'll see what that looks like. We have the content standards listed, all the references we use, so you know as a teacher where our sources are from, and our acknowledgments page. So if you look at the Rhode Island Women's Suffrage chapter, this was written by, this is our table of contents for the chapter, and here's the main essay. So this is written by Elizabeth Stevens. She's a local scholar in women's suffrage in Rhode Island. We ask the scholars to keep the essays between 1,000 and 2,000 words. So they're fairly short, but still a lot of information in there. And what I know some teachers have done is, depending on the reading level of their students, they have chunked the essays. And I hope the teachers in the audience know what that means, pulling out sections of the essays to have their students read a little at a time to help with that if it seems like it's still a little too long. There are links to other sources, other essays. For example, the Born Amendment was written about in another one of our chapters, and so that links directly to that. Since the chapters are topical and not necessarily chronological, there can be some overlap. And then we have definitions right in the chapter for students, and then also definitions at the end of each chapter here. And then we have guiding questions for each essay as well. And then off of the main essay, there are a number of side essays. There's usually about 3 to 5 side essays per chapter. And we usually use a primary resource from our collections. Again, sometimes we borrow collections from organizations we work with and use that as a jumping off point to the side essay. So the side essay is usually a deeper dive. So basically that main essay is like an overview of the topic. And then the side essay is a deeper dive into a topic. So for here, it's labor rights tied to women's suffrage. And this one is more about the 19th Amendment and how it was passed. And it features a political cartoon that was published here in Rhode Island. The Girls City Club, so this talks about women's organizations. And Bertha Higgins. So Bertha Higgins was an African-American woman who was really vital in women's suffrage for that community. And unfortunately, there are no images of her. So we ended up using a picture of her house that was taken for another project we were working on recently. And it explains why we chose that image and why that image is important here. And then it gets into the essay about her. And then that's similar for the side essays. There could be information about that primary source and then another essay about that topic, which might also have some images as well. And these essays were written by, some of them are grad students that work with us or interns that work with us. And they also have, again, definitions in here, questions at the end. And one thing I wanted to point out is, especially when looking, if you want to have a close look with your students, if you open the image in a new tab, you can really scroll, zoom in and have close looking, especially if you're doing any type of graphic organizers with your students. So this particular chapter doesn't have lesson plans yet, but we are looking at some grants that will help us develop some. So that might be something we'll do, is more close looking at some of these materials and putting together graphic organizers for that. I did want to point out, I know it's not with this chapter in particular, but I did want to point out some of the chapters have documents as well. So here we have a lot of images for this one. And the reason I wanted to point this out is, again, for that close looking. So here's an image, but we have that letter also in a document and transcribed, because the students aren't going to be able to read this, right? You could do some close looking with it, of course, and then help them out with a transcription. So we do try to do that as much as possible. Not everything is transcribed, but we are working on that. And back to women's suffrage, I did want to also show the additional resources page usually has links to other, again, some of the organizations that we work with, our sister organizations that are local, also have resources that are out there. So it helps to try to point you or your students to what else is out there. Something like the Roger Williams chapter, we have suggested field trips unfortunately, there's no suggested field trips for the suffrage chapter right now, but there are for Roger Williams. There's a lot of things around our state for him. And again, some chapters have lesson plans already, and some of them we're working on adding lesson plans to it. So a lot of this is a living document. We're adding to it all the time. And we'd love feedback. I'm going to plug this in a little bit. A part of what I need to do for the grant is interview teachers on using this, having them review this and then talk to me. So if you're interested in that, please contact me. I'm still looking for a few more teachers to do that with me. So while we're here, I'm going to go back to I should also say that Providence College Digital Library, they're the ones that have helped us set up this website. So we do a lot of the content, and they do, they design the website, and they do all the IT stuff in the background for us. So back to our main site, I did want to show that, again, under education, we have lesson plans. So our newest ones are 20th Century African Heritage Civil Rights. Again, hopefully we'll have a women's suffrage one if we get those grants. We do have a COVID-19 archive for Rhode Island, and we have lesson plans that go along with that. And then if any teachers are on that have been following us for a while, they might be familiar with some of these lesson plans that have been around for a while. But I wanted to just point out that they're all here. And especially this newer one, a lot of the primary sources are also separate. They're embedded in the plan, but they're also separate. And that's something that a lot of teachers had asked for when we put these together. And another resource you might find interesting is our Rhode Island History Journal. It is a searchable journal. It goes back to the 1940s up to 2018. So the newest issues of the journal, you have to be a member to get the journal. But as the journal gets older, I think it's 2 years back, then they start posting it and you can search it. We are working with Newport Historical Society to have a women's suffrage special issue coming out this fall. So I looked up women's suffrage. We don't have old issues about that. But again, you can look up other topics. Door Rebellion's a favorite. find it. It's in a PDF and you have it there. So this might be a little higher level reading for students, but it might be a good resource for teachers looking for Rhode Island specific information. And I think I'm talking a lot, so I will stop and I will turn it back over.
Oh, wonderful. Thank you. And if you're just joining us, welcome. We are so happy that you are joining us for this History Happy Hour. We are talking about women's suffrage and World War I and really focusing in on some of the great resources in Rhode Island and some of their digital resources as well. Do please be sure to join us in that chat box down there at the bottom. You'll see there's a little bubble. We'd love to hear where you're from. If you are currently teaching, what are you teaching? And you'll also see that there's a Q&A section, and that's where we'll be taking questions, whether or not it is specific to our current conversation, or if you've got questions about any of our organization's missions, just about teaching World War I in general. I hope I already have at least one person asking some of those questions. Do feel free to add those into that Q&A box along the way. Now I'd like to introduce Cherie Kelly of the National World War I Museum and Memorial. She is our school programs manager. And going to be really digging into some of the enduring impacts of World War I. Give me just a second. I think you're still muted. So let me just unmute you there. So Cherie, I think you might still be muted.
There we go. Is that a little bit better? I am also having just a wee bit of trouble sharing my screen. So would you like if me to- you have that PowerPoint pulled up, that would be great. So sorry.
Yep. Could you go ahead and start chatting and I will get that.
Brilliant. Brilliant. Great. So at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, we explore how World War I intersects with all sorts of global events. And women's suffrage is definitely something that has a direct impact. Now, it is not to say that this had not been an ongoing discussion for a long, long time. If you think back over the years, of course, there was the famous 1776 letter from Abigail Adams asking her husband to remember the ladies. There were radical women who, as early as the 1830s, were pushing for their involvement with political efforts across the country. There was the Women's Rights Convention in Seneca Falls in 1848, where you have the people of the modern movement that begin it with Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Lucretia Mott. And you also start to see a lot of African Americans who are making a push for their own involvement in being able to become politically active, in being able to have a political voice. And then, of course, something that so many folks think of when we start to think of the resurgence of interest in the 1900s, you think of the 1913 Women's Suffrage Parade, in which you are seeing Alice Paul and Lucy Burns, who are part of the Nation Women's Suffrage Association, or NASA, that are being more aggressive in their effort to get people on board for women's suffrage. That event actually was quite controversial in a variety of ways, not just for the people who observed it and who had some questions about the more aggressive stance, but also people who participated. It was a largely segregated event, which caused a lot of issues for so many of those folks, especially women like Ida B. Wells, who are demanding integration of this very important issue. You start to see a split between the different factions of those who are fighting for women's suffrage. You have Alice Paul and her supporters who are being more aggressive, even being outside of the White House and being political there and demanding attention. And then you have others who have been working so hard for women's suffrage for a long time, amongst other causes. A lot of times you had people who were also fighting for civil rights during this period of time. And someone that had been doing this for many years was Carrie Chapman Catt, who had a different idea than the more radical ideas of Alice Paul and company, who believed that more compromise would be more apt to get folks on board, that you needed on board in order to have that political favor curried, was more interested in the long game and a little more understanding of the compromise that may be necessary. And so after all of this time fighting for full citizenship within the United States, you see this tide turn. People had been tirelessly working for this, and yet many politicians just didn't feel that women's suffrage was necessary. It was kind of assumed that women would vote the same way that their husbands did, and so voting was a moot point, and you had a lot of political leaders who really believed that it should be a state's issue and not a federal issue, which also caused some complications. In his first term of office, that's included the president, Woodrow Wilson. He rarely spoke of giving women the vote, and when he did, it was usually to say that it should be a state's issue, refusing to address it at that national level. By the time that the United States entered the Great War in 1917, however, 15 states had passed full women's suffrage. Montana had already elected a woman, Jeanette Rankin, to the House of Representatives, and highlighting the reality that women could run for national office, but they still could not vote within those national elections. After the war continued, Paul's radical National Women's Party protested peacefully outside of the White House, but this was really quite shocking. People were not accustomed to the government being protested in a time of war. Suffragists maintained that silent picket with signs criticizing President Wilson and his lack of support for women's enfranchisement. Although it was initially tolerated by the police, protesters endured a lot of harassment and attacks without police protection. And they were later, of course, arrested for obstructing traffic. And while in jail, Paul and others maintained their protests. After a hunger strike, they were force-fed and beaten brutally. I don't know if folks have ever used iron-jawed angels in their classroom when teaching this, but of course there are the very shocking, brutal scenes of being force-fed, and once you have seen those, it really does stay with you. Other activists like Carrie Chapman Catt believed in that long game approach and believed it was going to be more appropriate. Catt believed that suffrage would be won at the state level. She focused her attention there, and she also believed the power of the presidency and that he would come to help the cause if he was supported in the right way. For example, she had pacifist feelings herself, but she urged women to support the war. In November of 1917, Catt gave a speech in New York. This was not a speech. This was actually a piece that was written for the crisis, where she said, "Over in Europe, the greatest war that history has ever known is shaking the foundations of kingdoms and empires. Millions of men have been blown to atoms in the Titanic struggle. Billions of dollars have been burned up in the smoke and fire of its battles. The whole world is locked in the struggle, and the struggle is to death. What is it all about? What's the idea underneath the horror and the heartache? What's it for? We all know the answer. Every soldier who straps on his knapsack and marches away to camp, bound later for somewhere in France. Every mother, every wife who weeps to see him go. Every woman who steps forward to take his place in industry, even the little child who is lifted to kiss him goodbye knows the answer. For democracy, for the fight of those who submit to authority and to have a voice in their own government. In the nobly simple words of the President of the United States is set forth the whole story, the great ideal, the democratic faith that is sustaining alike the men of the Allied armies on the battlefields of Europe, the women of the world waging their own double struggle to meet the new economic standards upon them while trying to secure a voice of their own in government. However men have seen it and may continue for a time to see it, women do count. Everybody counts in applying democracy. And there will never be a true democracy until every responsible and law-abiding adult in it, without regard to race, sex, color, or creed, has his or her own inalienable and unpurchasable voice in the government. That is the democratic goal toward which the world is striving today." Catt's words, as well as intense propaganda put out by the community, the Committee on Public Information, and many other factors that influenced strong patriotism, urged women to support the war effort in both word and deed. Now, lots of folks saw the war as an opportunity to not only serve their country, but to gain more rights and independence. With millions of men away from home, women are going to fill those manufacturing and agricultural positions on the home front. Others provide support on the front lines as nurses and doctors, ambulance drivers, translators, and in rare cases, even on the battlefield. To bolster the U.S. Navy, women were able to join the ranks as yeomen, non-commissioned officers. There are about 12,000 women that are enlisted in the Navy under the title yeoman. Most women yeomen served stateside on naval bases, replacing men who had been deployed to Europe. While many female recruits performed clerical duties, some worked as translators, mechanics, radio operators, telephone operators, translators, camouflage artists, and munition workers. They had the same responsibilities as their male counterparts and received the same pay of $28.75 per month, which is really quite remarkable when you consider that prior to this, women had really been relegated to that private sphere. And so to have that sense of equality and work besides men was really quite impressive. Also aiming to improve communications on the Western Front between the Allied forces, General John J. Pershing called for the creation of the Signal Corps Female Telephone Operators Unit. The unit recruited women who were bilingual in French and English to serve as telephone switchboard operators on the Western Front. The women received physical training, observed strict military protocol, wore identity discs, and worked very close to the front lines. These female recruiters were nicknamed the Hello Girls, a term which some of them felt disparaged their efforts, and became known for their bravery and focus under pressure. If you see the image here and you look at what is there on the back of these operators' chairs, you see not only do they have helmets, but they also have gas mask bags that are there, indicating just how close they were to the front and the type of position that they were in. So again, truly remarkable bravery required for this. It was not simply answering the phone. There was a lot that was going on there. One observer wrote that American women do anything they're given to do, that their hours are long, that their task is hard, that for them there's a small hope of medals and citations and glittering homecoming parades. It's not just women that are participating overseas. Women in more traditional roles equally contributed to the war effort. Every housewife in the United States was asked to sign a pledge card stating that she would carry out the directions and advice of the food administrator and the conduct of my household, insofar as my circumstances permit. What this meant was canning food for future use, growing vegetables in the backyard, and limiting consumption of meat, wheat, and fats. Most of all, women were expected to bolster the morale of their families at home and loved ones overseas. In the name of keeping things brief during our happy hour time today, because certainly this is such a huge topic and there's so much that we could go into, I'm not going to go into a lot of details about those specific roles, but certainly you can, of course, find much more information about the critical work that they performed if you will visit the National World War I Museum and Memorial website, which is found at theworldwar.org/learn. You are also going to be able to find more information about individual women there. It's often these personal stories that are really going to make students connect to understand the individual and to be able to build a rapport with that person. It makes what happened 100 years ago often so much more meaningful when you're able to get into that individual personality. So you have people like Grace Banker, who was the chief operator of the U.S. Signal Corps Women Telephone Operators. You also are going to have the stories that you'll find on our website when you are looking through the story of women in World War I and the story of suffrage in World War I, like Ida B. Wells and how she worked not only to progress the movement of working towards women's suffrage, but also to say this can't be a segregated process. This has to be something that is fully integrated. Again, something that was a real challenge for for someone to take on at that time. These beautiful stories of the individual can be found on our website, and we really encourage you to take a look around there and to discover those stories on your own. So how does all of this impact women's suffrage? Well, Carrie Chapman Catt had hoped President Wilson took notice of the way that women supported the war effort. In a somewhat shocking turn of events, Wilson addressed the Senate on September 30th, 1918, announcing his support of women's suffrage and encouraging congressmen to do the same when they voted on the 19th Amendment. He said in part, "The unusual circumstances of a world war in which we stand and are judged in the view not only of the regard, the concurrence of the Senate in the constitutional amendment proposing the extension of suffrage to women is vitally essential to the successful prosecution of the great war of humanity in which we are engaged. Come to urge you the considerations which have led me to that conclusion. It's not only my privilege, it's also my duty to apprise you of every circumstance and element involved in this momentous struggle, which seems to me to affect its very process as an outcome. It's my duty to win the war and to ask you to remove every obstacle that stands in the way of winning it. Are we alone to refuse to learn the lesson? Are we alone to ask and take the utmost that our women can give, service and sacrifice of every kind, and still say we do not see what that gives them to stand by our sides in the guidance of the affairs of their nation and ours? We've made partners of the women in the war. Shall we admit them only to the partnership of suffering and sacrifice and toil, and not to a partnership of privilege and right? This war could not have been fought either by the other nations engaged or by America if it had not been for the services of the women. Services rendered in every sphere, not merely in the fields of effort in which we have been accustomed to see them work, but wherever men have worked, and upon the very skirts and edges of the battle itself. We shall not only be distrusted, but shall deserve to be distrusted if we do not enfranchise them with the fullest possible enfranchisement, as it is now certain that other great free nations will enfranchise them. We cannot isolate our thought or our action in such a matter from the thought of the rest of the world. We must either conform or deliberately reject what they propose and resign the leadership of liberal minds to others." And so there's a lot going on there within this entire speech. One, it's his support of women and recognition of how much they have done during the war, recognizing their capability, but also making an acknowledgement that we are pushing for democracy. That's why we're fighting around the world. What will it look like if we are refusing full enfranchisement here at home? With the election of 1918, there were ushered in new members of Congress that were friendlier to suffrage. So a different vibe, if you will, than what had been in Wilson's first term. The support like Wilson's also added to the 19th Amendment being adopted. The House of Representatives voted to approve it May 21st, 1919, and then the Senate followed June 4th. Using language from an amendment introduced in 1878, the 19th Amendment was introduced and passed. In order to be ratified and adopted, the legislators of at least 36 states at that time, a two-third majority of the 48 states, needed to vote for approval. By the end of 1919, 22 states had done so, but anti-suffragists had defeated the measure in Georgia, Alabama, South Carolina, Virginia, Maryland, and Mississippi, with many fearing a disruption of legal segregation. Tennessee was the last state needed to obtain ratification of the amendment. And as the story goes, a 24-year-old representative received a last-minute note from his mother urging him to vote yes. 8 days after the state of Tennessee voted to ratify the amendment. It was delivered via mail to the Secretary of State, becoming law, on August 26th of 1920. Now, it is important to note that this did not give universal suffrage. It prohibited the denial or abridgment of the right to vote on the basis of sex, but it didn't guarantee that right to all women. First generation Asian Americans of all sexes were barred from citizenship until 1952. Congress granted citizenship to Native Americans in 1924, but some states barred them from voting until 1957. Poll taxes, literacy tests, and voter intimidation prevented generations of African American voters from going to the polls until the 24th Amendment banned poll taxes in 1964, and the Civil Rights Act of 1965 prohibited racial discrimination in voting. In Puerto Rico, local voting rights for all women were not assured until 1935, and language barriers still kept some from voting until bilingual ballots were required in 1975. To date, full access of federal voting rights are not assured in U.S. territories. So that's a lot of quick information, but there is great information on our website so that you can take a look at this information in greater depth and at your own leisure, where you can go into it a little further. And thinking about ways that you can use this information, especially some of the primary resources that were just provided, we're going to take a look now at some of the conversations that can be had in classes. I included passages from two primary sources. These documents offer students a fascinating opportunity to analyze objectives and compromise. A comparison of the two documents, both the written work of Catt and then also the speech provided to the Senate by Wilson, show that both Catt and Wilson took surprising action in the course to the passage of the 19th Amendment. Their willingness to compromise to achieve the larger goals makes for some really interesting class discussions. There are some good questions to consider. Both Catt and Wilson made compromises to their original goals. Catt was a staunch believer in civil rights, but recognized that if suffrage must be provided equally to all Americans, that 19th Amendment may not pass. She was willing to make the compromise to support a president who had some segregationist ideals. While she was a pacifist herself, she supported Wilson and the war. So those were some of her personal compromises. Wilson, who changes his mind about women and the vote, does so as a compromise in order to get the vote and enfranchisement and increase American democracy. Well, that's what we were fighting for across the world. I think it's important to look at the history and see what led to those compromises. These are people that were politicians and really fought for what they believed in. So why was their compromise? Why'd they make them? And how did their concessions or their change of heart impact the ultimate outcome of the ratification of the 19th Amendment? Those are some interesting questions. They have a lot to do with political behavior, and you can do a lot with that in terms of looking at politics today. Who is willing to make compromises? What happens if you don't make compromises? How far do folks get if they do not? And do you think that these folks were right to accept those compromises? Also, you can ask questions like why you feel Wilson changed his mind about women's suffrage. And if you think that Catt's long game plan as a staunch civil rights advocate who was amending some of her beliefs or compromising on them, helped to make that happen. It's interesting to look at everything that was going on and who perhaps had the greater influence over Wilson, his ideas, and ultimately the passage of the 19th Amendment. So these are, again, lots of ideas to talk about quickly, but we do hope that you are able to look at some of the resources that we have available and find your own great ways to incorporate this information into your classes.
All right, next. And I'm going to start this with a fast introduction by saying, Sarah, if you can go ahead and start your camera again, because I did close yours off. It is our pleasure to invite Sarah Carr, Assistant Director of the Museum of Work and Culture, to add more to this conversation and to share more about the online resources that are available, talking about labor history, talking about the fact that it was in fact women's labor in World War I that really helped change the tide and move this amendment forward to ratification, something that had been in the works for over 50 years. So to shed some more light on labor history, Sarah is joining us. And Sarah, do you have a slide to share?
Yes, so I can share my screen. My name is Sarah Carr. And I'm going to share. Okay, so can everyone see that? Great. Okay. So our museum, the Museum of Work and Culture, tells the story of both immigration and industrialization at the turn of the 19th and 20th century, and primarily looking at the community that we're located in, Woonsocket, Rhode Island, which was once the most French city in the United States, with 70% of its residents being French Canadian. So we tell the story of both their arrival into an industrialized world from an agrarian world, and the long-term impact that that had on that community. Most recently, given the circumstances that we all find ourselves in, we have been working to try to make as much of our material accessible online as possible. So we have created 4 separate turnkey Google Classrooms for teachers that they are able to request copies of. And I will actually, since we're talking a little bit more about labor history, I'm going to select, while I scroll through all the copies that exist for teachers, I'm going to select the original one. So this is one that we have that's focused on unions and labor. And all of the material that we have, we've tried to separate it into units that make sense for teachers at all levels. Once you receive your copy, you're able to use what material you want, remove material, add, invite your students. And we try to work sort of from generalities to things that are more specific. So this is looking specifically at unions and labor, which includes material on women's involvement during that period of time to improve both the lives of themselves and their children who were suffering, I feel like suffering is the right word, suffering under child labor. So we have materials here that are include some, and let me see if I can better action, actually. So we have 4 Google Classrooms, American Industrialization, Immigration in Rhode Island, Unions and Labor, and then Making History in 2020, which includes our suffrage material. But if we take a look at some of this classwork and our child labor, you're going to see, we also include some of the EnCompass material that Geralyn was showing you earlier. So it's just a different format that includes some of the amazing material that the Rhode Island Historical Society has to offer, including the history journal that she showed us, the EnCompass essays that they have, the primary source material. It's just in a different format, and then also supplemented with other assignments that the museum has created, discussion questions, videos, so all here and easily accessible for teachers to do with what they will independently. As I was saying earlier, this specific classroom on American industrialization takes us through those transitions from farm to factory, as well as the start of the Industrial Revolution with Samuel Slater in Rhode Island. It tells the story of child labor more in depth than our union classroom does. However, this has a lot to do with what then leads to that story. They work together really well. And then a specific look at Rhode Island mills and products. Going back to the union and labor classroom, we're able to see a look at the labor unions that existed, how they work, what they are, again, giving that background information, strikes when workers walk out, the textile strike of 1934. We also offer a lot of really wonderful information about Elizabeth Nord, Anne Burlack, and Grace Lee Boggs, all of whom were really active in the labor movement at different periods of time. And we also have the writing exercise Vote for Me, which looks at a different aspect of what it meant for women to be able to have a voice during this period of time when they ordinarily had not been able to have one when women's suffrage was finally passed. But if we take a look at Making History 2020, so this classroom features a few different units. It's taking a look at the census that's taking place in 2020, the COVID situation we all find ourselves in, but also voting in the United States since it is an election year, suffrage in Rhode Island then and now, and a century of women's suffrage. So we have material here that covers that entire period of time. I will say suffrage in Rhode Island then and now, it includes a look at the Dorr War as well as some of the Rhode Island women's suffrage movement, the labor rights and women's suffrage movement, and then Bertha Higgins and Black women's suffrage. So we chose to include that under specifically suffrage in Rhode Island versus a century of women's suffrage. This material tells a little bit more of the national story of what was going on during that period of time and analyzes a bit about both who is deciding who has the right to vote, what that means, asking those kinds of questions of your students, includes material both from the Rhode Island Historical Society and the National Archives. So this is what we have on offer from our end. And I'm happy, these are the four classrooms that we've chosen to offer. If people would like additional materials or have different topics, we are certainly welcome to, we'd love to hear from you about what you need and the best ways that we can be supporting educators right now and looking ahead to our next school year. I will stop sharing my screen. And I know that we are running short on time for Q&A, so I don't want to say much more.
No worries. And Geralyn, if you can go ahead and start your camera again, we'll go through a couple of these quickly. Do, again, please feel free to add things into that question and answer. I'm going to grab what was one lone question in the chat, and just so that you can, Geralyn, speak to this very quickly about women's meetings. That Susan Zoll found that gatherings of all sorts were oftentimes used to discuss the suffrage movement. She was asking whether or not there was reference to women's meetings in EnCompass.
I answered her privately. We don't have a side essay about that, but I did tell her that I can help her reach our reference librarians to find out more information. Then she started asking more specific people. Same thing. I will actually email the reference librarians and CC her and then see what we can find.
Outstanding. Also, Catherine, you just asked a really great question as well about materials on Catholic women and suffrage. So do feel free to follow up with Geralyn and the reference libraries at the Rhode Island Historical Society. That's really one of the great things about these sort of conversations is that when you do have that specific question, if we don't know as museum educators, we know the people who will know if our organizations have that sort of information. So thanks for asking that question. Looking at some of our other questions, and there are some really great ones here. I'm gonna start with the easy one. Thank you to the anonymous attendee who asked this. When someone says they're celebrating the centennial of women's suffrage this year, what would be an appropriate response? I will happily punt that to Geralyn or Sarah. I know what my answer would be first.
They should be saying commemorating. how to nicely answer that. I would say not everybody received suffrage, just like what you're talking about. It didn't give suffrage to everyone, so it's not really something that we would necessarily say we're celebrating in full or 100%. We usually use the term commemorating when we talk about this year.
Yeah, that's one of those things in history, I like to say, actually, many people think that, but on the specific part, and then just people find that they can hang their hat on a specific detail. So it just depends on what is the specific detail that is most interesting to you. And Cherie mentioned many of them. So if it is that, as a matter of fact, Native Americans didn't receive citizenship until 1924. And even then, and even that was provided in part because of their fighting in World War I, or it could be taking it to that conversation about Asian Americans or the poll taxes and the civil rights movement in the 1960s, or U.S. territory still today. So I would find one of those and use that as just my hook. I generally find if I've got one good fact, and if I leave people thinking about what they want to Google, if I leave people wanting to Google something more, I generally feel like I've done my job well as a museum educator. Ron asked, it has been commonly discussed how the Great War impacted the women's suffrage movement. Can anyone speak on how or whether the influenza of 1918-1919 impacted the women's suffrage in both the US and worldwide? That worldwide question is a really good one and a very broad one, because some nations like New Zealand already had women's suffrage. And so that's going to really be on a bit more of a case-by-case basis. And I would be happy to follow up with you on that if you're looking for a specific nation. But very specifically inside the United States, Carrie Chapman Catt actually suffered from the influenza, suffered from influenza. And so she was in that pain and in that space trying to lead a nation's movements. And just like today, where we are experiencing different political movements, where people are canceling their gatherings and the like, the same thing was happening during the suffrage movement. And so women and men who had been fighting for this right prior to World War I, where this really was seeming to be moving along with that progressive movement, where women and men, but particularly it's women who paused what they were fighting for to get involved in the US war effort. And then right as the war is ending in November 11 of 1918, they're on the second, they're heading into this major pandemic, this 1919 flu pandemic, many times inappropriately called the Spanish flu, because this, you know, Spain had a freedom of media at the time. That's the reason. It's not that it actually started in Spain. So there was, I think, a lot of disheartening because of that flu, that they couldn't do everything that they had wanted it to. And yet at the same time, you know, women's work in this nursing effort as well, not only have they proven themselves on the battlefields and on the home front, but primarily nursing was the work of females, and showing their efforts there on the home front and healing a nation. I think that also too helped cultivate a shift in how people thought about the roles of women and whether or not they deserved a fuller citizenship inside the United States. There's, Emily, you've got some great questions in here too. So I'm going to read off three of Emily's questions. One of our other panelists, you get to choose one. And then Emily, we will follow up with your others. The first question, can you talk a little bit about how women used Wilson's speeches about Germany against him? They called him Kaiser Wilson because they say he was a hypocrite. Are Can you talk a little bit about how Chapman Catt is a controversial figure today? She once said that white supremacy would be strengthened by women's suffrage as a way to win over Southern state support. These are really great questions. And actually, I'm going to say that, Emily, we're going to end on your last question. And so, Sarah or Geralyn, this is aimed at either one of you. Are you collecting stories of Rhode Island women and suffrage?
No. It's not a bad idea. It's just not a project that we're working on right now.
Outstanding. Now, if you have more easy questions like that or other really difficult ones, like Emily has asked, and yes, I think it does give me a little bit of time to answer the question of absolutely, Woodrow Wilson was seen as a hypocrite. That beautiful sign that we see in the photo about calling him Kaiser Wilhelm. And if you go through images, particularly at National Archives and some of the other spaces, there's a lot of really great references to how he was fighting for the world to be, to make the world safe for democracy. Those eight words that basically changed the face of American foreign policy. And it was clear to people back then that that was not the case, not only not for women, but not for many people within the United States. There's a lot more that we could dissect in that. And Emily, feel free to email us at education@theworldwar.org. I want to finish up our conversation here quickly as well. First, I just want to say, again, thank you so much for joining us. I also need to say thanks to the United States World War I Centennial Commission. I'm gonna very quickly just run through some of these slides so that you can see. It is because of their funding that we are able to do some of this. They are working on building the National World War I Memorial in Washington, D.C. Our first national memorial to a war was in the 1980s on the Mall. And since then, many others have built up, and they are completing right now this work. You can see what that piece looks like. It is right by the White House, so we encourage you to go check out their site, www.1cc.org. It is with them and the Gilder Lehrman Institute and the National History Day that we have worked on showing a lot of lessons of World War I. There's a great lesson, and I apologize, there is one about women and World War I that you can get off of our education resource database. You can find that at www.theworldwar.org. We're really excited about adding Rhode Island Historical Society and their resources shortly to our site as well. Clearly, it is about finding the best resources. It is not just about the resources of the World War I Museum and Memorial. Join our newsletter that is also in association with the World War I Centennial Commission that is topical. So if you're looking for things like women in World War I, looking at the global impact of the war or the end, we just did a really great one on the influenza pandemic. Even if you are not a teacher, I highly suggest it. There's some really cool stuff there. You can check that out at the website. Also, all sorts of primary sources that would be available for you to take a look at. Online exhibitions. If you are cooking straight out of your cupboard right now, I really can't recommend more some of the World War I recipes that are available in an online cookbook from Warfare, a Culinary Exploration of World War I. Scholastic, again, with the World War I Centennial Commission, we go through some of these different lessons, including women in the war, global impact, life in the trenches, etc. We've got some more online learning opportunities that are coming. Feel free to join us on Thursday. We're going to be in conversation with Dr. Allison Finkelstein of the National of Arlington National Cemetery, talking about memorialization and Memorial Day at home. What does Memorial Day really look like this year? And how can we do that in such a way that actually leans a little bit more into what those who had lost loved ones in World War I had wanted for us, the generations of the future, to be considering. Thank you all so much. On behalf of everyone on this call, from the Rhode Island Historical Society, the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and the United States World War I Centennial Commission. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to connecting with you more soon.